Namaste, everyone. Welcome to the Charvak podcast. This is your host, Kushal Mehra. So today's podcast is going to be fun. I have with me Rahul Roshan. Rahul, thanks for coming on the podcast.
Yeah, I hope I survive the onslaught after this podcast. You have been an outcast, a villain recently, you know, yet it's a great courage on my part to share screen with an outsider, a traitor, I don't know, many things. Anyway, we are not going to discuss that because neither you nor me are experts on that. In fact, I'm expert on nothing, so that we will come to later. But yeah, thanks for having me.
Yeah. So by the way, you know, as soon as we started, the first comment on the live stream was Sahara Pranam.
right.
And the second was help Rahul and ICICI.
Whatever money, any money that you might make today, at least 60-70% of that you should transfer to me.
Yes. So everybody, please go and help Rahul at ICICI. So all right. So now to the serious stuff. So today's podcast is about the discussion of your pinned tweet. So if people do not know what your pinned tweet is, so how about this? I'm going to read it for them. So you had mentioned the establishment is the bunch that systematically controls your thoughts through media and academics, not the government that's there for 5 years. And then you had added another line, which you had quoted, and you say controls your speech and actions through judiciary. So now let's expand on this. Batao. Kya kehna hai? Exactly how do they control our thoughts and how do different? So let's start with the media and academics. Baad mein judiciary pe jayenge, but where the media and academics, how do you think they control our thoughts?
Yeah, but before that, I would want to, like we should start from first principles. So, you know, when we talk about establishment, that's where the entire confusion is, because most of the people think that establishment means, those guys who are in power. You know, I mean, like basically the ruling party, the government. But in my view, and I think this is a view that has been shared by many of late, the party that rules, the party that wins elections in any part of the world is not necessarily the establishment. You know, I mean, you just see our neighbors. The army is the real establishment there, right? Who wins the elections there, it doesn't matter. You don't even know whether those elections are fair and, you know, stuff like that. So that's the first thing that we need to understand, you know, especially because I come from, I mean, not very vast, you know, except for that Sahara Pranam, I haven't been much of active journalist in the field as such. But in journalism and in journalistic language, establishment always means, almost always means, like the party which is in power or the political party which currently has formed the government. And they project that media should be anti-establishment. That's their exact term, where they say that we want to, that the role of the media is to be almost like the opposition party, that you are against the establishment, which is the ruling party. Now, that's where I, the entire idea of writing that pinned tweet was that that's a wrong notion, that the party which is in power, or rather which is in office, is not necessarily the one which is controlling all aspects. Because what is establishment? It's a system. It's a bunch of what also is known as the ecosystem, but institutions, it's the entire way we have collectively agreed to govern ourselves, and who gets to control in that scenario. Because the whole idea of being a civilized society is that we have some set of rules to which we all submit to. And that's how we are different from the anarchists, or for that matter, any other anti-democratic or you know, stuff like that. So Dutch, I mean, a party only by winning an election, does it mean that it starts controlling every department, every organ of you know, this the whole bunch of different entities that collectively form this establishment, you know, and which is where I have specially mentioned that the media, the judiciary, and you know, the academia, these things are there, and so that's the origin of my tweet. Now, sorry. When we come to how they control, then, you know, I mean, I would expect that this should be obvious. But yeah, maybe many times what we think are obvious things are not so obvious. So the academia and the media, obviously, the way they define, I mean, I'm talking about thought control, because that is the biggest control. You know, it's in any rules, any regulations, any law, they can keep changing, you know, but some established norms or how to put it, you know, in any standards of moral behavior and all that, those are very different to change. They almost become timeless. You know, it all started with religion. I mean, that's a dangerous territory to go with you. But religion was the original establishment in a sense that it defined what is wrong, what is right, what are the no-go areas, and obviously the whole concepts of sin and punishment and everything. Now, obviously, we have come to a modern secular society where these things, religion or religious bodies or thoughts, don't control these things. You know, for what we are going to be punished is decided by a very secular law. It's not decided by a Hindu law as such in context of India. So what I wanted to say is that for what you are going to be punished, these whole rules and regulations, these are formed not by just a party which have you know, won in the last 5 or 6 or 7 years. These are the rules that have been formed over you know, churning and a lot of upheavals that we have gone through in the last 100 years. I mean, I'm talking about what we have currently. Obviously, the way it has all evolved goes back to thousands of years. As I said, initially, it was about religion, very, 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 very long back. Then the kings and, you know, these things. And so in terms of modern laws and the modern rules to which we submit to, I would say that the this is, you know, if I can put a time frame, maybe at best 150 years, not more than that. Now, that's what you are looking at, you know, in those last 150 years, or even say just take 50 years. What were the forces who were defining what is going to be acceptable, what is going to be not acceptable, what is going to be punishable, what is going to be not punishable? So in my view, those are the real establishment, you know, those entities, those people, those ideologies, those thought processes, those systems that define that, you know, what is going to be acceptable or not acceptable, they are the they together constitute the establishment, and media and academia and judiciary, I mean, as so far as my pinned tweet goes, these obviously play a very, very, very critical role. Academia, because, you know, that's where your entire thought process is molded, you know, I mean, especially for a Hindu family, the child is raised more by the state rather than by the parents. Yes. Especially if the parents are not too conscious of their cultural or, you know, or whatever, moral values or history or whatever. I mean, unless they and it's not just about Hindus, but say about any religious group, that unless they consciously try to impart those values, which are from their religious books or not, mostly people are pupils are going to get secular education system. Now that's where obviously our constitution allows minority groups to run educational institutes where they also impart religious values, all in the name of preserving their character and I don't know what else. But in that sense, somebody belonging to a non-Hindu community, he gets secular education as well as religious education. Both because those groups or those parents are more conscious, as well as the constitution allowing them. But in case of Hindus, unless the parents make that effort, send their children to some particular organizations or outfits where they can go and impart extra values or a different set of values. Or even if same set of values, then with a different perspective, these things don't happen with Hindus. So a normal Hindu child is raised by the state. He is truly Chacha Nehru's bhatija, right? So that's how academia is the biggest tool in controlling your thought process, and that's why it's most important part of the establishment. Because those are your formative years. Those are your school and your college years are when you develop a conscious of your own and a belief of your own and identity of your own. And who are the forces that are going are controlling those institutions? Who are the people who are writing those textbooks? Who are the people who are going to decide what kind of attitude is going to get you a pass mark or a grace mark or whether you come out as a topper, stuff like that. Everything is not STEM. These things do matter in many of the subject matters. What ideologies you profess to, these affect your grades and stuff like that. So that's where academia is the biggest part, I would believe, and it should be obvious that the people who mold your thought process, they obviously are the biggest establishment. Then comes media, because once you get out of school and college, who are the other people who are mostly impacting you? Obviously your close social circuit is there. But this whole celebrities, this whole and by media, I don't just mean the news media. Mm-hmm. By media, I mean the entire mass media, which includes your entertainment which especially includes your entertainment, actually. And it includes news as well. But news is very small part of it. Even if you look objectively, all those weekly ratings that come of Bach and all that, you'd see that the entertainment channels are way, way, way ahead than the news channels. So when I mean media, media which includes entertainment, and right. So once you are out of school and college, then these are the people, these are the entities that go on to shape your opinion. Your popular perception, because you don't have lots of time to study various things and make your own conclusions. So you in a way outsource these things to certain people. On occasions those are journalists, and on occasions unconsciously or consciously you even outsource it to your favorite Bollywood actor, lyricist, and people like them. And so since you have outsourced your thinking to them, obviously they are controlling your thinking. So that's how media and academia, obviously, if I have to put a hierarchy, then media comes first, academia first, comes first, then media, and then the rest of the work is done by judiciary. If at all you survive these two institutions and you go on to develop your own free thought, your own true dissent and rebellious understanding of the things, then judiciary is there to correct you. That you simply cannot explain. You simply cannot say those things. You cannot propagate those views. They would brand it as hate speech and stuff like that. So that's the trinity of the true establishment, in my opinion, the academia, the media, and the judiciary. And that's and the way they control, I believe, it should be obvious. Go ahead.
So it sounds like, Aristotle used to talk about, Aristotle was never a supporter of democracy. So Aristotle, in a very weird way, was a supporter of aristocracy. So Aristotle used to say that, there should be some people who are these, aaj ki bhasha mein jisko bolte eminent intellectuals. These eminent intellectuals would actually decide what is good, what is bad for the society. And Aristotle had this thing, ki nahi nahi. So in a very weird way, don't you think that what was happening in India for the last so many years, and I still think although it has diluted significantly, and I don't know what your view is, I think it's diluted significantly, but we still have this aristocracy, right? These aristocrats, and it's a self-certification process, right? How do you certify the other person is an eminent intellectual? Well, he agrees with me, so obviously he's an eminent intellectual. So how does one then break this aristocracy? That's what I'm trying to understand. We get it. It's actually a very, very, very dangerous system that we have. But there are two angles to it, right? First would be, how do we break this aristocracy? And the second thing would be, I am someone who believes that there should be expertise, right? Expertise matters. If we are talking about, say, biology, we should talk to someone who's an expert in that field. Similarly, if there are field reports, I know people, we have created a culture of dismissing all social sciences, but I think social sciences have a lot of value to offer in terms of real life also. So where is that line where the aristocracy becomes a closed group and we don't know what to do, which is good, which is bad, which input is okay, which input is bad? How do you think we can actually come out of this conundrum?
I should clarify it that, in fact, I started with that I'm no expert on anything. Unfortunately, two postgraduate things that I studied. In graduate, I studied mathematics, most of which I have forgotten, thanks to journalism, because I never could use it. In fact, mathematics, in a way, most journalists are almost against it, not obviously by as if there is something that they are hate about it, but the way they reject data and logic. So after graduation I have studied journalism and MBA. Now both of these make you just a jack of all trades, right? So what philosophy, and those things are terms I might not know. What Aristotle said, what someone else said, I might not know much. I would be very candid about it. So my approach to solving everything is almost through first principles, almost through basic things. I don't really have a set framework in my mind to refer to. Now, the way you are putting it, and it obviously, I think, in that sense, I don't know which society we can refer to as having the real democracy. I mean, in some sort of way, perhaps every system till now has been of some element of aristocracy has been there. The moment thing has come under strain, suddenly people are, the aristocrats, the elites are suddenly saying it's not democracy. You often hear that by Trump's opponents and back in India as well. So till the time it was suiting them, till the time it was all right to form, get 30% or 40% of vote and form the government. And the guys in the power were people who were elites or people who used to entertain you, keep you in some sort of power sharing. Everything was all right. And the moment, that's aristocracy, if the way one can put it, has gone, they have started rejecting that, you know, this is not true democracy. Now that's where they should be honest, you know, like the way you have put. And they have a very they are very good icon to refer to, Aristotle. You know, they should say that they are against democracy. You know, that the whole idea, and many people, and I know that many philosophers, many people do say that democracy is perhaps not the best way to govern ourselves. I think one of the very popular adage or saying is that it's the, you know, among the all available form of governing ourselves, this is the least troublesome. I think, you know, someone had put it that way. And but I don't think, you know, these eminent intellectuals now agree with that. They should actually be saying that they are for aristocracy. And that's how a true debate can happen. You know, if you pretend that you are for democracy and when in actuality you are for aristocracy, then how do we really, you know, go on to have a solution? It's very clear that you are, you know, these people are not against, these people are against democracy. They don't believe, and they have reasons. You know, I also would agree that everything cannot be decided by a vote of majority. So whether you call that aristocracy or meritocracy, I don't know what terminology you use, but there is some merit to that argument. So how do we solve that? But at least start, you know, you should have that honesty to admit that you know you do believe that in certain areas, in certain form of governance or self-governance or whatever, a democracy is not best suited. At least be honest and come with that proposal, and then we, you know, go ahead and discuss and debate. Then what else? If democracy should not be there, then who defines the, you know, expertise in certain domains? I mean, who will define, who will become the experts of, say, what is moral and immoral, or what is punishable and not punishable? You know, if we are going to be, you know, I mean, like, who will define the constitution, for example? Should it be a religious constitution or secular constitution? Who all will define it? I mean, in a way, in India, obviously, it was not democracy that defined it. It was a set of people in the constituent assembly, you know, who debated amongst themselves and arrived at a constitution. And I don't think, I mean, I'm not sure, it needs an expert view, and I'm not an expert of history, but I don't think our constitution was ever put to a vote that a popular vote that do we accept or reject it. I don't think so, right? I think it was the parliament which debated and which voted and that passed it. So there was never a direct vote on adoption of constitution, right?
Yeah, there wasn't. But the thing is that they would say that the idea, the British had the idea that we are giving the country to the most probable representatives of the people, right? So
I have no problem with that. I have no issue with that. But in that sense, you know, one can argue that even the constitution was not, democratically adopted. So it gets very tricky. I mean, the people, the MPs, how do they become experts then? You know, I mean, this is such a big thing that you are going to define the basic structure of the constitution, and and it's never put to popular votes. It's going to define everything that the nation is going to stand for. Now, on what basis the expertise was defined, right? I mean, if someone says that popular vote is not always the solution, and you need aristocrats or elites or experts, then on what basis? You know, I mean, these are even now that you have asked me, even I am loudly thinking, and I cannot find an answer. Except that 1 lakh people came together, voted for someone, that guy reached parliament, and now he becomes expert on how to govern, right? I mean, I don't know. I mean, that sounds pretty,
As far as our constitution was concerned, the only thing we had were the Constituent Assembly debates, where we were debating constantly about the different facets of our democracy. And that's right. The only part. And I think other than that, we did not have any real discussion. And beyond that, I mean, the proof of the pudding is in the eating in a way, Rahul, right? We have had so many amendments to our constitution that itself so shows what a bad and a shoddy job we did in the first place, because the people were never satisfied, and these people go on amending the constitution so many times.
I mean, my basic premise was that at the end of the day, the most important part of our modern living, the constitution, is being decided by, in a way, ordinary people. You know, they didn't crack any entrance exams. They didn't become experts via some scholastic, training or, rigor. So, at since democracy has been pretty, it's been working, right? So, you know, I mean, where does the whole idea of aristocracy, you know, the merits of that argument come in? Like, you know, if the same thing which was running through the same standards of deciding by the majority, all right, for the last 50 to 60 years, how suddenly and why suddenly you have started developing doubts about it? You know, so that is the real question that should be asked to people who do believe that there should be, you know, some element of expertise and all that should be there. That if it was working all right for now, what exactly has changed? Except for two names, Trump and Modi, they cannot say anything. Now, that's not a logical way to argue. You know, if you want to change something, you have to come up with, you just can't brand anyone fascist and say that, okay, since now fascists are winning, now this whole idea, what has been working till now, that no longer works. That's bullshit. I mean, that's as fascist as it itself can get. So I don't know if I have answered your question, because, you know, as I told you that I don't understand most of these terms. While I do appreciate some, merit in such arguments of aristocracy or aristocracy or meritocracy, I don't understand that what is the trigger of bringing in those arguments currently, except for a very dishonest, selfish reason that you don't like people who are currently winning by the same system which came through, you know, these very institutions that you yourself created.
Yeah, so if I was to put you a proposition like this, my biggest grouse with what we call the establishment in this discussion is that they created a setup, albeit whatever it was. I think still India should take a lot of pride in the way we have set up our democracy. We have flaws, but I mean, we are far better than most countries in the Asian continent, at least. I think we are far better off than those countries. But here's the thing. The idea behind the democracy was always that there is a representative system and people are going to showcase their will and their intent through their representation. Now, when the representation has changed, the aristocrats in this country, the eminent intellectuals, they feel left out, because it's simply that the country has changed, the country's idea has changed. The country still believes in democracy. They exercise their democratic right, and they basically kicked out the establishment. Now, in such a case, don't you think it is a classic case of Kisiani Billy Khamba Noche?
Obviously, you know, I mean, see, we are currently living in a era where this whole, you know, all the terms, everything has become inverted. You know, like, normally, people like me would be called conservatives, and, you know, people, these eminent intellectuals would be, you know, the liberals. Now, I am not trying to conserve anything. I am trying to destroy and change. So in what sense I am conservative, right? I mean, it's the liberals who are trying to conserve the old power structure, you know, that the entire way in which decisions, political, big political decisions, big policy decisions were being taken and in the way they were, you know, whining and dining with the high and mighty. That system is somewhat collapsing, and they are trying to preserve that system and conserve that system. So they are the real conservatives, you know, I mean, the liberals. So that's the issue. I mean, the problem with these guys are that they always use terms which are very fancy, But they are actually doing exactly the opposite things. I mean, if you are saying that here are people who are trying to take away your freedom and all that. I mean, who are these guys? In the last 5 or 6 years only they have come. In the last 5 or 6 decades, it had been you. So how can they suddenly go come and control everything? Now that's very, they have to justify. Why do they say so? One, do they understand? Do they accept that all the institutions that were created by the same liberal, people who have ruled and who created those institutions since the independence, and in fact going back to before independence, all whether it's be judiciary, whether it be your universities or any institution that you take, media, that they were so badly designed that a Modi comes from Gujarat, he wins one elections, or now he has won two, and he completely overhauls everything. I mean, just because he has won two elections, he starts controlling every organ of the state. Then who created such a bad system to begin with, which had no checks and balances? So if Modi or the new guys who have started winning in the last 6 years, if they have really infiltrated, in your word, not exactly infiltrated, but if they are controlling everything, then who designed these weak systems? Then accept that these institutions were so weak that anyone who could come in power, who could have an office, could control it like a dictator. Then why were you not having these problems earlier? Then these are systemic problems, right? About the institutions, the way they were designed. Suddenly, Supreme Court becomes compromised. How? I mean, were these institutions so weak? So either you accept that Congress and entire set of people, or everyone who has been ruling India since independence, they were working with highly compromised institutions that could have been compromised in like a snap. Either accept that, or or the Sanghis whom you keep on blaming as illiterate idiots, either they are so smart that they have suddenly become judges, bureaucrats, and big journalists, big writers. So either the Sanghis are not so anti-intellectual, they are not so bad. I mean, they perhaps had a very secret mission for the last 20 years in which they decided to hide their Sanghiness, and they worked their asses off, and they cracked the UPSC, and they went everywhere, and suddenly Modi comes and they all come in front, right? So one of these two things you have to accept. Either Sanghis are so smart that they were already in judiciary, in bureaucrats everywhere, or these institutions were very weak. So I mean, you cannot have it both way. I mean, if Modi is controlling everything, then that by default that means that Congress or you guys were controlling every damn thing since the independence, because Modi has not made any constitutional changes. And that's actually one of the pet peeves of many of his fans, that there are many things in the constitution that needs to be changed, especially about, say, the minority rights. I mean, this whole constitutional provisions that allows people of non-Hindu origin to preserve and conserve and propagate their entire idea, and that benefit or that advantage is not available to Hindus or stuff like that. Many of the Modi supporters have been calling for constitutional amendments to be done. I myself agree. I mean, I would want the minority ministry of minority affairs or whatever it is, it should be simply scrapped. You have a social justice department which identifies some socially backward segments, in which Christians and Muslims are also there, and they are already getting benefits through Ministry of Social Justice. Then why do you need minority affairs ministry? This is one of my demand, that I would want it to be a demonetization of policy in that sense, that this ministry must go. And, you know, this is a very, very small example, control of temples, and there are many things that Modi supporters have been asking to be changed, and these things require change in constitution. Now, Modi hasn't touched anything, and if he has been able to control everything, then how compromised were these institutions really? Yeah. So either accept that they were highly compromised, they were highly corrupt institutions, that anyone could, anyone after winning an election could control it, or you accept that you are a big hypocrite who keeps on crying. You suddenly finds the same institutions compromised, which you were singing all pains earlier, right?
Yeah. So one thing that I actually, and I had mentioned this to you offline too, that I think you should add to your pinned tweet, so you should re-quote the quoted tweet, is that I think the establishment needs to be updated, because obviously in 2014 it was not the case, but the more and more India gets digitized and more people go online, it's funny that we are even having this discussion on a monopolized online platform like YouTube, albeit that it's going to be streamed on other two, but let's take the four major platforms that we have these days, whether it's Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, and Instagram. Now, obviously, right. Instagram being a subsidiary, I think, of Facebook, if I remember correctly. Yeah. So now here's the thing. Now, you don't have competition. See, capitalism works well only when there is competition. The reason we have such cheap data rates in India is because we have capitalism in India. We have competition. So there is Bharti Airtel, there is Vodafone Idea, and then there is Reliance Jio, and the net result is the consumer is benefiting. But the case in the internet is that we have completely zero competition. Even if somebody wants to launch a social media portal today, it's next to impossible. And now these aristocrats in the academia, they have trained certain people who have now gone and sat on chairmen as chairmen or in boards of these big companies. And it is now, as they say, the establishment and its tentacles keep expanding, right? Like the bark of the tree, and then the roots go further and further and further, and the roots keep spreading. Now, don't you think that the biggest worry to me, if people call me a fearmonger or whatever, but I believe that the single largest threat, in a very weird way, it social media initially was a net positive because it smashed the control of the establishment.
Right.
Because it was basically these people were there and they never thought there were so many people who hated them. And suddenly now they have people who hate them telling them, we hate you. Then they realize, okay, they speak over here. Now we will control this too. Now, what do we do in such a scenario where the establishment has identified that the one space where these others who are the masses are there,
right.
Now we have to control them. So how do we deal with this phenomenon? Because this is the one place, because this is where true democracy was. And I know, you get the good with the bad. I mean, I have been on the receiving end of it too, but it doesn't matter. I still believe this is a beautiful venture that we created as human beings, where we actually could question a lot of people. But now that these people are trying to capture it, like I'll give you an example on Twitter. It has nothing to do with our culture, but you can't dead name a person. Basically, it's like, so Caitlyn Jenner was Bruce Jenner at a point of time. So if you accidentally call him Bruce Jenner on Twitter, your account will be suspended all life. That's it. Yeah. Done. And now where does this idea come? It comes from the academia and critical race theory, and gender is a social construct. So they have reached there too. How do we deal with this particular conundrum? Because this scares me the most.
Yeah, it should. And I wouldn't, redefine my pinned tweet. Because, what we are talking about is media. You know, I mean, it's called social media also. So when we talk about media, now it includes, this social media, Facebook, Twitter, and all these platforms. And your entertainment media, which is also now, mostly digital, Netflix and all, and your news media. So it all comes under media. What started as, sorry, I hope it's not Corona. So what started as tech companies are now media companies. You know, these all are media companies because they now decide what type of content will go there. Now, they were once tech companies, but they no longer are tech companies. And that's how it always is. I mean, you know, like even if you go in traditional media, what is traditional media? You know, your newspapers, your television, your radio, and maybe even your books, right? Now, at the core of it, everything is technology. You know, you had printing press, you had airwaves, you had how to downlink and uplink, and you know, all those kind of technologies. Now, the technology part is different. You know, so that's where currently we are confused. That when we talk about a Facebook or a Twitter or Instagram, you know, these things, there is a technology that drives them, but these are no longer technology companies. They were a technology company at one point of time. So, you know, so defining Facebook or Twitter keeping it as entities which are not media would be very wrong. It would be almost like saying that NDTV is not media company, but it's a uplinking and downlinking company. No, it's not a tech company, right? So Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, all these are media companies. And this is where biggest democracies, whether US or India, they should be very clear about, you know, these companies have to be identified as media companies. The moment you decide what is hate speech on your platform, you are a media company. You are controlling, you are allowing a certain element of what you call discretion coming in, and you are editorializing content. So you are a media company, as simple as that. You had the option that you say that we will go by whatever the respective laws of the land say. You know, we will remove if a local kachahri, whether in Pakistan or in India or wherever, in Germany or wherever, if they come up with a decree, we will remove. In fact, currently they even don't have option, they will have to remove. Twitter, at some point of time, I think they acted very brave and they tried to fight the judiciary in US also, that, you know, that our privacy, our ideas of privacy are different, and, you know, we are not going to cooperate and stuff like that. But thanks to all that, those activism starting from there, when you were standing with a normal user and not giving his coordinates to a state government, to right now suspending users just because their speech doesn't match, you know, some of your pundits that you have hired, so from that activism to coming to this one, now you are no longer a tech company. You know, no longer how much you innovate, no longer, no matter how much you innovate, no matter what new products you come up with, your entire nature is now of a media company. And this is something I think Trump was also talking about, that he will take away the safeguards of these tech companies, which they gain by arguing that they are just tech companies and not media companies. So one is that these are media companies. Now, how they came on to have a control over it, obviously it needs a study in itself. You know, I mean, since it all was working fine for every company, every of these platforms to give equal opportunity to everyone to express their views, and I think at some point of time in their growth, they hit a plateau. Maybe I think, you know, we do need to study, you know, it's a very complicated thing, because ultimately the companies will take decisions that make them, you know, that has financial sense to it. You know, they will not take decisions just to please some bunch of fools who consider themselves intellectuals. So there has to be some element of commerce obviously involved in it, and it has evolved from that entire woke culture, you know, like where you start putting pressure on corporates. So the real issue here is not really these platforms, but corporates. You know, the entire corporate, these brands and these FMCG kind of companies, they are all monetizing this entire, you know, woke ideas. you know, whether it's whether they want to sell a Pepsi or whether they want to sell a cigarette or anything for damn matter, marketing you know, ideas, their advertisement ideas necessarily has these days some woke ideas. You know, they will, I mean, you are talking damn, you are selling a car or a Maggie or anything, but you will talk about how homosexuality is good, how women's right is good and all that. So you know, so it starts from there, that this entire thing, this you know, trying to flaunt your liberal, trying to flaunt your woke standards, that has become profitable. You know, that has become profitable for individuals, and that has become profitable even for the corporates. And once you decide, once your advertising strategies are aligned with certain ideologies, which again, you know, we need to figure out how exactly that happened. Since when did, you know, showing a guy doing puja at Diwali and buying a new car, since when this advertisement not become lucrative enough for a car seller as compared to him trying to show that, you know, two same sex couples are having, you know, fun in a car, you know? So these things, how they have, my guess would be, again, this is purely guess, again, completely journalistic analysis, but I think at some point of time, they hit a plateau. It started with the advertising sense. They ran out of ideas. They suddenly figured out that, okay, the new marketing currency is in woke ideas. So the entire advertising was first controlled by these wokes. You know, that what kind of advertising messages, what kind of marketing strategies we should come up with. And and the money is there. You know, I mean, like the Facebook, the Twitters, the Instagram, they all are driven by ads. So once your advertising is aligned with certain kind of you know, political beliefs, then you know you have that power to arm twist these companies as well. So Facebook, obviously, once you start pulling out ads and their quarterly revenue starts going down, then they will agree, they will say that, okay, fine, we have to at the end of the day, we have to make profits, and if the corporates are going woke, then fine, we are also going woke. So the way I would analyze it, that it all started with advertising. Because of advertising pressure, that's how every damn media works. Everything that changes in media is not because of some great editor, but it's because of advertisers. So advertising pressure was there, you know, and obviously at the same point of time, Trump winning and all that also had, you know, its elements, you know, playing its part. And then they had no choice, you know, these tech companies, which are now media companies, to align themselves with what is, you know, what we are now seeing, where the same guys who were controlling, you know, who were gatekeeping and controlling information in traditional media companies are now in the same roles in these modern media companies, which are Facebook and Twitter. So I would draw the genesis to advertising. And that's how, you know, the pressure was put on these people, advertising as well as some investment and all that. And now we are in a position, in a situation where there is a real danger that, you know, the difference between the modern media, the new media, and the traditional media, the entire censorship, the entire gatekeeping, the same stuff we could be seeing, you know, in the modern technologies. And you are right. That's the biggest, that should be the biggest concern for people who are truly the dissenters, who are truly the disruptors. I mean, woke people are not the dissenters and disruptors. So that's I totally agree with. The only thing I changed was that these companies I would club in media. I won't redraft and re-quote my own tweet. They are part of the media.
All right. So one last question, and then I'll start taking the live viewers' questions too. So now we have to discuss some tangible solutions to this problem. Otherwise, people will be like, "Yeah, yeah, dara ke chale gaye, kuch to batao." So my idea is that I honestly believe this, that some people say the strategy is we should, you know, replace the old establishment the aristocracy with our people. That is a gradual process which takes years over the period of time. My view is maybe I am always someone who leans very libertarian. I believe that at the end of the day, a good society and a functioning society is a society where people have rights and privileges and freedoms in their own hands. Then what happens is the establishment doesn't matter. The establishment becomes immaterial beyond a point. In a country like India, what we have done is we have given this establishment, which is the Babudam, the judiciary. I mean, who the hell is the judiciary to decide dahi handi ka pyramid kitna hona chahiye? Kya hai ye? Matlab kya ho raha hai?
Oh God, ये हंसी जो है वो contempt of court तो नहीं हो जाएगी. I take back my laughter.
So, I mean, दिवाली में 10 बजे पटाखे जलाओ. सुबह साउथ इंडिया में दिवाली सुबह बनाते हैं तो तुम लोग सुबह जलाओगे. नॉर्थ इंडिया वाले रात को बनाते हो तो तुम लोग रात को जलाओगे. इट इज रिडिकुलस. माय पॉइंट इज दैट व्हाट शुड बी द सॉल्यूशन, और इट इज अ बिट ऑफ बोथ, कि आप रिप्लेसमेंट भी करते रहो एंड एट द सेम टाइम आप उसको छोटा 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 बनाते जाओ कि इन द लॉन्ग रन वो इतना छोटा हो जाए कि द इम्पोर्टेंस डजंट स्टे एनी मोर एंड वी कैन कंट्रोल आवर लाइव्स आवर सेल्व्स एज अ सोसाइटी.
I would have agreed with you. I am a lapsed libertarian. so what you are suggesting is something I would have, without batting an eyelid, I would have agreed 5 years back maybe. But over time, I have become very, my senses have become, I have become paranoid in a sense about my identity and my culture. And I'm still in that sense, I'm still exploring and evolving what should the new label, if at all, I should have, because I'm no longer a libertarian for sure. And that's why what should be this new, set of ideas that we should be adhering to, it's something that's still evolving for me. The book, I must promote my book also in when I have come here. It's about that, this transformation came, happened in my life. And currently, I am at stage where I'm not too sure that, this whole libertarian ideas can work. Primarily because in the libertarian crowd, I could not find many people whom I could identify myself with. At the end of the day, I think you would agree that every human being, we are social animals. No matter how much we try to say that we are, free thinkers and stuff like that, at the end of the day, some element of tribalism is needed by everyone. Unless obviously you are a complete anarchist, and I think in that sense you don't need a sense of community, you don't need a sense of identity. But even anarchist for that matter is a label, and people proudly associate themselves with that label. But anyway, without going into that those kind of things, you do need a sense of community, and I think the libertarian crowd or the libertarian community in India, or for that matter anywhere, they look good debating. They look good taking stance at some one thing or other, but they often fail at achieving something, and especially when it comes to Hindu thoughts and Hindu causes. I have seen libertarians lapsing into what is a regressive left, aligning themselves with those kind of thought processes. So that's where I left libertarian thought process, because I thought it was just people were calling themselves libertarian but they were not. That was the trigger. But anyway, I think that human society perhaps is not at that point of evolution or maturity where libertarian ideas can really create a working society. Can you name any society? Maybe with an exception of Scandinavian countries, if not even them, maybe I don't think any society really is rooted into libertarianism.
I think the closest society where the state has the least interference in your life, funny enough, is actually the United States of America, where the state actually doesn't interfere a lot. People think actually it does, but having got family there and having lived there myself, I have a first-hand experience that now the wokes are trying their best to interfere, but they believe
they're not trying to. No, they are not trying to. I mean, whatever we have discussed, the biggest challenge that you yourself put on the technology company, which are media companies, the genesis of that entire problem started from the United States, right? So if that country was really rooted in libertarian ethos and ideologies, this problem we shouldn't have been staring at. So even if you say that the United States is a society, is a country which is based on libertarian principles, how come these guys became so powerful then? How come they put on their own university on fire when someone like Milo, the Berkeley was put on fire, I believe, when Milo was to address a little gathering over there. Taking from there to this whole woke culture trying to control Twitter, Facebook, and everything, they all have started from United States. It didn't start from India. So that also I would say that it's a misnomer. It's a wrong belief that US, or maybe, I mean, maybe you are right that US is based on those principles, but what outcome did it have? You know, if the leftist fascists are ultimately controlling even the corporates and even the the academia, then how exactly do you go on to? U.S. is not your your advertising mascot for libertarianism. Then I mean. Are you saying that we create a society and then we end up like US? No, I mean things are really bad over there. The woke, I mean the ugliest woke faces are to be seen over there. I mean not literally, figuratively. So why should I settle for libertarianism there? In that sense, I would actually agree that in that sense, US constitution, US society, the state has a very limited role. But this is what we have, we are seeing over there. So right now I am a little conflicted. I can settle for a civilizational state. For that matter, let me read that book of Rajiv and Harsh, A New Idea of Civilizational India, what all they have argued. Or whether it means Hindu Rashtra, I don't know. I mean, I'm, as I said, I'm still evolving and studying it. But libertarianism, I personally have lapsed. And I don't think, there is any good example anywhere in the world where this has worked, except obviously in debating societies. So I'm very much leaning towards having a civilizational state. I mean, not leaning, I'm almost decided that it has to be a civilizational state, whether it's Hindu Rashtra or what.
But won't an Indian civilizational state or a dharmic civilizational state be actually a small state, because the nature of Hinduism as such is plural and diverse, and Hinduism tends to be very pro-diversity. So to handle the diversity, you would actually need a very small state, because otherwise, if a very large state concerns, then it becomes very un-Hindu, right?
I don't think so. First, this is something I won't discuss with you because I don't want abuses. and to be very honest, as I said, I myself am, in that exploratory phase. I do intend to, have some discussions, understanding with people to understand, on some level, you can't even define who is Hindu, right? So these clarities do need to come, when we are talking about a civilizational state or a Hindu Rashtra, what exactly do we mean? It's high time we debate, we codify those things so that, someone like you, cannot come and create that this is Hindu Rashtra and this is not acceptable. F- first let us come, figure out what exactly is that Hindu Rashtra we are talking about, or what is that civilizational state? What are those core civilizational values that we are talking about, and that those should drive? But broadly, the way I believe is that in our civilization, whether you call it the Hindu civilization or the Sanatani or the Dharmic civilization, we do have values that can take the best of libertarianism and not allow something like what Vokes have been able to do. So I actually agree with that.
I never agree with the full-on anarcho-libertarian philosophy. In fact, in my own view, I have come a lot more away from that. Like, when it comes to national security, I'm an absolute hawk. I believe that nations and boundaries and borders do matter. And maybe my only difference of opinion is always going to be on freedom of speech with most people. Other than that, I think I'm very hawkish on national security. Like, I believe agar koi thokega to return mein thok do unko, aur double se bhi zyada thok do. To meri to soch hamesha yahi rehti hai. Okay, let's start taking a few questions. So, actually, very good questions. So, somebody had said, did you see the meme on Shyam's show? Yes, I have shown him the meme, so it's okay.
Why are you laughing so much?
It was funny. I liked it. So, okay, Jamin has asked a good question. He says, your view that in the name of the ecosystem, a lot of times herd mentality is pushed and low-hanging fruits and reasonable principles are sacrificed or neglected.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, this is something that has been a recurring a point of discussion in the last three or four, and that's, I think, only three or four YouTube interactions I have done. And I'll repeat what generally in normal parlance we understand as ecosystem, we confuse it with a syndicate, right? So what people push as ecosystem is they are trying to push a syndicate. And that's true that in many ways, substandard ideas or whatever, the concern was in the question that gets pushed. But these are part and parcel of the problem, I would believe. One day I would create, talk about what exactly is this ecosystem. But it surely is not about always agreeing with each other. In my last interaction, somebody had asked me about you, that, about after that incident. The atheist incident, for those who don't know, you got millions of abuses. So I told them that, in ecosystem, you don't always agree with each other. Sometimes you do attack each other. I mean, if you look at Congress and left ecosystem, the Naxals and the Peachy Dambram, they are actually part of the same ecosystem today, but they jailed each other. Operation Green Hunt mein to mari diya. And forget Peachy Dambram and Naxals. In fact, Naxals have killed mainstream communist leaders. I come from Bihar. Many Naxal factions have killed each other. So, lekin le de ke wo bhi to sab ek hi ecosystem ke hai na. I mean, we should be fortunate ki kam se kam actually to goli nahi maar rahe hum log ek dusre ko, galiyan hi de rahe hain. So far as ecosystem is concerned, what we understand is a close-knit group, which is not an ecosystem, obviously. It's a series of interdependence. I think the one thing that everyone should understand in the ecosystem is the interdependence part. That should be there. If you are always agreeing with each other, then that's a one-sided dependence. There is no interdependence, right? So it has to be in some, you will not always agree. Many of times your causes, your concerns, your interests will conflict with each other. But at some point of time, there would be some interdependence that cannot be broken away. And if that interdependence is broken away, something very crucial is going to be lost. So, this appears very vague kind of a definition, but this is the definition. The interdependence, and if that interdependence is gone, something very crucial is going to be lost. So that, keep that in mind. And that's the ecosystem. But yeah, going to the moot point, yeah, since we don't understand what is ecosystem, most of the people, maybe, you know, on occasions even I can say stuff that's not most accurate. That doesn't mean, you know, ecosystem surely doesn't mean that you always agree with each other.
Yeah, I think so beyond the point, people need to get rid of the purity and pollution tests, because the history of humanity.
Those tests can be there, but that maturity has to, you know, you demarcate and define the boundaries. But that maturity has to be there, that you don't, you know, declare everyone out of the, you know, an alien to the ecosystem. I would rather tell them that, you know, you type ecosystem, you go into Google Images. You see a man and a tiger are part of the same ecosystem. Or wo to tiger to aapko kha jata hai. A person and a plant is part of the same ecosystem, and it's not just food chain. You know, it's an whole out of, you know, interdependence. So you define who is a man, who define who is a tiger. You define jisko jo define karna hai, usse mere ko problem nahi hai. Purity test up karo. कि मेरे इस इसमें कुशल मेरा है वो फिट नहीं बैठता, बट इज देयर सम इंटरडिपेंडेंस व्हिच वेयर कुशल मेहरा इज हेल्पिंग यू इन सम वे, एंड यू नो इफ यू हेल्प कुशल मेहरा इन सम वे, देन द ब्रॉडर ऑब्जेक्टिव एट सम पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम इज बीइंग रियलाइज्ड. Then Kushal Mehra is part of your ecosystem. That's as clear as that. He's not part of your identity. He may not be part of your group, however you define yourself with, but he can still be a part of your ecosystem if there are those interlinkages.
Yeah. So basically, मतलब तूने रंगा वाली बात कर दी, तो रंगा ने तुझे बोला था कि तुझे Twitter वर्णन सिस्टम बनाना पड़ेगा, तो अभी बना दे तू फिर.
मैं वर्णन सिस्टम तो हायरार्की में भी आ जाता है, यहाँ तो मैं सिर्फ इंटरलिंकेजेस की बात कर रहा हूँ, वो जरूरी है लोगों को पहचानना.
चलो ओके, सो फिर हितार्थ ने अच्छा क्वेश्चन पूछा. हितार्थ सेज, हाउ डू यू सी मोदी गवर्नमेंट proceeding about the academia, where then he specifically says positive views only, we know the negative already.
right, academia mein to kafi Modi government ko wo padti rehti hain galiyan. To be honest, maine itna study kiya nahi hai, NEP wagera ki bhi bahut baat chal rahi hai ki usme kuch log keh rahe hain bahut galat hai, kuch log sahi hai. I won't say on policy level there has been any major changes that, you know, we can flaunt. I mean, this is something that should happen. But on a very basic and, you know, operational levels, many good things have been done. You know, things that we might not, which might not be apparent to everyone. And I'm not even apparent to me. I mean, I'm not someone who, you know, who has access to the corridors of powers and I know stuff. Lekin jo chota mota jo bhi mere ko thoda pata chalta hai. I mean, like, it has been in universities also, things are changing. Just like, abhi aap dekho na, ki agar, if CAA is passed aur uske against 15 eminent intellectuals koi letter likhte hain, do din ke andar academia ya jurist ya jo bhi hain, wo iske फेवर में भी एक लेटर आपको मिल जाता है, राइट? सो 50 एकेडमिक्स और स्कॉलर्स और 60 एकेडमिक्स और स्कॉलर्स सपोर्ट सीए, यू नो 60 50 फॉर्मर अभी 25 फॉर्मर जजेस, दे से दैट दिल्ली पुलिस इज राइट ऑन दिल्ली रैट्स इन्वेस्टिगेशन. नाउ ये तो खैर ब्यूरोक्रेट्स और वो हो गए, लेकिन कई बार ऐसे यू ट्राई टू रिकॉल, ऐसे कई सारे इंस्टेंसेज आ जाएंगे जबकि पुशबैक एकेडमिक्स में भी एक सर्टेन लोगों की तरफ से हुआ है. और उसमें ऑब्वियस सी बात है कि मोदी गवर्नमेंट का डायरेक्ट इनडायरेक्ट हाथ तो मुझे नहीं कहना चाहिए, मतलब उसमें एक वो लगता है कि जैसे कोई बहुत बड़ा सीक्रेट मिशन इनका रहा हो, बट द इंटायर थिंग दैट द गवर्नमेंट इज देयर हैज अ रोल टू प्ले, एंड ऑब्वियसली सम अपॉइंटमेंट्स, सम direct and indirect messages that go, you know, to institutions, that shows ki cheeze to badli hain. As I said, policy level pe I cannot put because I haven't studied, not because it might not be there, but on operational levels many things have changed. मेरा भाई खुद IIM में प्रोफेसर है एंड ही इवन अग्रीज दैट थिंग्स हैव स्टार्टेड चेंजिंग. पीपल लोग बोल रहे हैं, दूसरे तरफ से आवाजें उठती हैं, पहले की तरह इनका एक तरफा कंट्रोल नहीं है. सो बट या पॉलिसी लेवल पे और कुछ डिमोनेटाइजेशन जैसा हो जाए तो बढ़िया है.
ओके, किसी ने बोला प्लीज आस्क राहुल टू क्लेरिफाई व्हाट ही मेंट व्हेन ही कॉल्ड यू एन एफएमजी ऑन ट्विटर बिकॉज़ यू हैव बीन डिक्लेयर्ड अ फास्ट मूविंग कंज्यूमर गुड.
नो नो, दिस इज अ रैंडम term that was invented by this guy Doga karke Twitter pe. So I thought I told you, if you also don't know, then today you should know that FMG means filthy mountain goat, and I don't know why. I don't know what does it I mean, I like the term, you know, and imagining you as a filthy mountain goat is also good.
Ajay, now next question is, please ask Rahul if he thinks that those who pass exams and become IAS officers are any better than ordinary people who win elections. That's a very good question, actually.
True. Actually, very, very good question. I don't think I have respect for both of them. You know, I mean, we have a culture of making fun of babus, but it's a very tough job. You know, I mean, up and both of babus as well as politicians, when you have to go and deal with ordinary people, भैया जिनको meme समझ में नहीं आता, sarcasm समझ में नहीं आता, you know, और जिनको दूसरे type तरफ के politicians कुछ भी बता के चले जाते हैं. अभी only yesterday this fat guy from आम आदमी party, Sanjay Singh, yeah. So he had put, you know, a photograph of some corn flour, jo 60 rupees mein bik raha tha, and he compared it with money that a makka gets you. You know, to sala, matlab aap bhutta le jaoge ghar mein aur usko corn flour koi bhi bana dega kya? Beech mein kitne sare process hote hain. You know, I mean, it जो टेक्नोलॉजी, रिफाइनरी, डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन चेन, वो सब का है, और उसको इतने रिट्वीट्स मिले. ऐसे अपटार्ड्स हैं जो कि उस पे उसको ब्रह्मवाक्य मान लेंगे, जिनको इतनी छोटी सी चीज नहीं मालूम कि भैया मक्का का जो प्राइस है उसको आप कॉर्नफ्लावर के प्राइस से कंपेयर नहीं कर सकते. ऑब्वियस सी बात है, उसमें बहुत अंतर होगा क्योंकि बहुत सारे कॉस्ट एड होते हैं. तो when you have to day in and day out deal with such kind of people, it requires really, you know, very different kind of skill sets to deal with them, and politicians especially have to have that those skill sets, and even the bureaucrats, you know, aap kahin ke dm vm ban jao to aapko kal ko aa jayega aisa koi mota aadmi aapke dm office mein kahega kyun ab kya, how do you debate with them? You know, it's very easy to debate with you know, debate and abuse someone like you, rather than someone who cannot understand ki bhaiya bhutta aur corn flour ke price mein fark kyun hai. So I start with this disclaimer that while we make fun of you know, politicians as well as bureaucrats, unki job thodi tough hai. It's not easy for all of us to, you know, usually log kehte hain MBA wale, unko aap direct usme bureaucrats wagera bana diya karo. Policy level pe to theek hai, लेकिन MBA करके भी आप मैनेजर अच्छे अच्छे कॉर्पोरेट में रहोगे, कितनी डिसिप्लिन्ड वहां की वर्किंग स्टाइल होती है, वो आई एम डैम श्योर कि एक वो स्टीव जॉब्स को साला कानपुर का डीएम बना दो, वो दूसरे दिन भाग जाएगा. सो इट्स नॉट, आई मीन स्टीव जॉब्स तो बेचारे नहीं रहे, बट यू नो यू गेट द ड्रिफ्ट. तो सो दैट्स द आइडिया. नाउ या व्हेन यू कंपेयर बिटवीन दीज टू कि बाबू एंड पॉलिटिशियंस, ऑब्वियस है कि बाबू के साथ एक एक्स्ट्रा जो है एडेड क्वालिफिकेशन इज ऑब्वियसली द एकेडमिक क्वालिफिकेशन. नाउ इट ऑल डिपेंड्स कि यू नो व्हाट काइंड ऑफ क्वालिफिकेशन दैट हैज. अगर कोई यू नो, आई डोंट थिंक एनी पॉलिटिशियन, आई मीन पॉलिटिशियन कैन बी इलिटरेट एंड ऑल दैट, but I think most politicians are they have this common sense and understanding ki agar unko kuch cheeze nahi aati to wo ek babu se ya kisi expert wagera se pooch le. I mean if somebody asks just like that too, obviously, because someone is more qualified to lagega wo banda better hai. But both of them have very different skill sets. They complement each other. I don't know. It's a tough question, actually, that between bureaucrats and politicians, who is better suited? They both should complement each other. Lekin abhi to kya hai ki hamara aisa system hai ki worst to dono ke worst ek dusre ko complement karte hain.
Yeah.
That's the problem. Yeah. The best of both should complement each other. So.
Yeah, true. So Sanjeet has asked, aren't the owners of social media important sense of righteousness usurping the old establishment and not necessarily for good? I think we have covered this.
Right. Yeah. Your voice cracked, but yeah, to whatever extent I could hear, I think we mostly covered it, that it's not their sense of righteousness. I personally believe that it all goes down to, how the advertising industry took a left turn, and that put a, commercial pressure on, these Facebooks and Twitters and Instagrams and all. And now you have this regressive left or this woke left trying to infiltrate and control everything. So they are doing it because it's something that is market linked. If we can break those market links, I think if we can somehow convince the advertisers ki bhaiya ye wokeness ke chakkar mein mat padho, and that's where actually these boycotts are very good. Unfortunately zyada ke zyada work nahi karte, but if somehow these big brands, these big companies, they feel the pinch ki ye jo so called conservatives ya jo right wagaira hain, ये लोग जो हैं इनका बॉयकॉट का फर्क पड़ता है, इनके बॉयकॉट से हमारे बैलेंस शीट पे प्रॉब्लम होएगा, तो वो ये प्रेशर वो फेसबुक और गूगल पे डालना और इन पे डालना बंद करेंगे. तो वहां पे मुझे लेकिन कोई भी छोटे से भी बात है बॉयकॉट ये ट्रेंड करके भूल जाओ वैसा नहीं होना चाहिए, बट ये पावर दिखानी होगी, एंड दैट्स वेयर थिंग्स माइट चेंज.
Yeah, I agree with you. But actually, there is some positive news. I'll give you the news from America. So what is happening is a lot of this wokeness got to sports, right? So NBA or ye sab mein kaafi wokeness ho gayi. So their ratings, the amount of people watching NBA has nosedived so low that so they actually are now considering taking it back in a very big way.
Right. So that's where, I mean, if it starts hurting them financially, तो ये सारा woke का भूत उतर जाएगा उनका. तो that's where we need to figure out how.
Yeah. So there is a Nastik Sanatani who has asked you, Rahul, you've often stated that we have 20 years till the Marxist-Islamist nexus causes irreparable damage. Say inertia holds, how do you envision in events unfolding that brings us to that execrable state?
ये तो शशि थरूर ने तो नहीं पूछ दिया है, अच्छा भारी भरकम शब्द है. I have not often said, but जैसे मैंने कहा था कि I am in a way paranoid about a few things, and one of these is this thing. I pray to God that I am wrong, that my paranoia is completely it's unfounded. But there are certain things, which I have put on Twitter also earlier, that, these guys, Ram Guhas and all that, they keep trying to equate that India's India of today is like Hitler's Germany. It's not like that. I mean, the parallels that we can draw is actually exactly 100 years back. So India of 2019 is like India of 1919, and in 1919 the Khilafat movement had started, and in 2019 you had either in Jamia or JNU on the walls they had written Khilafat 2.0, that in that then also. In 1919, the entire Khilafat was around, this whatever was happening in Turkey. And today, this Turkey, is trying to become, with funnily with Pakistan and Malaysia trying to project themselves as the leader of the Islamic world. So parallels are there actually from 1919, not from 1930 or, you know, Hitler or Mussolini. Those are obviously, bullshit provocations that they come up with. Or maybe, I mean, if they can come up with, then I can also come up with a comparison. So that's how, in my mind, things are repeating from that era. You know, if Mahashay Rajpal was killed for Rangila Rasool, you had Kamlesh Tiwari being killed for, using unsavory terms for the prophet. So there are parallels in that sense. And so that's where my paranoia comes from, that if from 1919 with Khilafat and with, later on with Rangila Rasool and all that, if we ended up having a partition in 1947, what are we looking? What are now we looking at in 2047? So I'm not saying that kind of partition is going to happen again, but we surely can learn from those times, the mistakes that we did, the stuff that Hindu leadership or the Hindu community could have avoided. So I would want everyone to go back to that era, study, and study by their own, not from the liberal, point of view, because they will blame everything on the Hindus, So there is actually an article, an interview which was published on Scroll, which virtually blamed the partition on Mahatma Gandhi. Imagine. You know, right? And I think it was Wendy Doniger, or I don't even know if I'm pronouncing her name correctly. It was her interview, and the title, if I remember correctly, was that partition could have been avoided had Mahatma Gandhi been a little less reverential towards cows. So Mahatma Gandhi believing in cow protection is being termed as the reason for partition, which is, I don't know. I mean, galiyan hi bak sakta hu ispe. So itna Islamism ko itna whitewash karte hain, aur wo aaj bhi ho raha hai. Whatever you if you try to point out anything about Islamic supremacy, you would be shout down as coming up with hate speech and stuff like that. So it's all getting repeated. वो तो उस जमाने गांधी को तो ये प्रटेंड करते थे, प्रटेंड कि गांधी इज वेरी गुड, द ओनली थिंग गुड दैट दे लाइक अबाउट गांधी इज हिज मर्डर, नथिंग एल्स. यू नो, इफ गांधी वाज नॉट मर्डर्ड बाय गोडसे, एक 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 बूंद इज्जत नहीं देते ये गांधी को. द ओनली थिंग गुड अबाउट गांधी इज हिज डेड बॉडी फॉर द लिबरल्स, बिकॉज ही कैन दे कैन फ्लॉन्ट दैट डेड बॉडी दैट दिस इज हाउ हिंदुत्व इज डेंजरस. भैया, तुमने उसके बाद भी तुमने गांधी को ब्लेम कर दिया पार्टीशन के लिए.
और वो भी ऐसा ना कि गांधी को गलती से एक हिंदू ने मार दिया, मुसलमान मारता था तो वो भी नहीं करते थे.
हाँ, तब तो गांधी पे कितने अभी तक वो आ जाते कि गांधी ने क्या क्या गलतियां की जिसके कारण ये मोहब्बत फला जो हैं इनको इतना गुस्सा आ गया, उन्होंने गोलियां चला दी. यू आर एब्सोल्युटली राइट कि अगर डायरेक्ट एक्शन डे या पार्टीशन के दिन गांधी को किसी मुस्लिम ने गोली मारी होती, so you can just imagine the kind of narrative that would have been around his death. So right. so in short, whatever was happening then, and whatever has been presented of incidents that happened in those times, how everything about Islamism was whitewashed, how it was projected as if partition was pushed because it was Congress was a Hindu party and Muslims were somewhat not satisfied with it. Imagine, I mean, a Congress which is controlled by Gandhi, who sings Ishwar Allah Tero Naam, I mean, Allah ka naam ek bhajan mein aa jata hai, and by a Nehru, who by himself is agnostic and is not, so proud about his Hindu roots. In these two guys being on the top, aur ye Congress bhi bahut Hindu thi unke liye. और उस, एंड सो दे ट्राई टू कंप्लीटली वाइट वॉश everything, you know, from an Islamic supremacy point of view that caused the partition. और आज भी वो वही कर रहे हैं कि ये CAA के नाम पे दंगे होते हैं तो उसको वो dissent दिखा देते हैं. So that's my paranoia comes from there, that you know it's almost in repeat mode from that. And what do we do that we don't end up with another partition in another you know 2 or 3 decades? So that's what it is. I mean, the solution in my mind obviously is to, you know, that every Hindu should become aware of it. You know, it's not at all about hating Muslims and you know, removing them from India and all that, but at least you should be aware that what caused the partition. This is something that was never taught to us. I mean, hame to ye bata diya angrezon ne phoot dalo aur raj karo isliye partition ho gaya. Bullshit. Phoot to thi hi aur wo phoot dalo raj karo aise hi thodi na ho jata hai. Wo kaise wo kaun what was the ideology that allowed Jinnah and people to be so strong? वो सिर्फ आप अंग्रेजों पे ब्लेम करके नहीं निकल सकते ना.
एग्रीड. सो जाने के पहले मैं तुझे बता, शिवम शर्मा तुझे कह रहा है राहुल जी गिव अ रेस टू अजीत भाई एंड नुपुर जी.
हाँ भाई, और अभी लोग और हमारा रिवेन्यू बढ़े, लोग पैसा दें तो मैं भी उनको दूं.
आंसर द सॉल्यूशन फॉर अजीत भाई एंड नुपुर जी इज support@opindia.com.
अरे नहीं, वो तो ईमेल पे ना भेज दें opindia.com/support.
So उस पे करो. चलो, सो बिफोर वी गो राहुल, वन लास्ट क्वेश्चन. सो बुक कभी आने वाली है तेरी? कभी प्लान कभी है?
या द पब्लिशर सेड कि इट शुड कम अराउंड फेब्रुअरी 2021 ऑब्वियसली. सो इट स्टार्ट्स गेटिंग इनटू द एडिटिंग प्रोसेस सूनर और लेटर. थोड़े बहुत उनको जो रहेंगे, भैया इस पे कुछ लीगल प्रॉब्लम ना हो जाए टाइप, वो सब पे थोड़ा यू नो आगे पीछे कुछ कुछ होएगा. एंड होपफुली यू नो इन अ फ्यू वीक्स वी अराइव एट अ फाइनल ड्राफ्ट. इनिशियली तो दे वर यू नो काइंड ऑफ अनश्योर, यू नो दे थॉट आई माइट राइट समथिंग लाइक 50,000 to 60,000 वर्ड्स एट बेस्ट. उस हिसाब से उन्होंने पूरी स्ट्रेटजी बनाई थी और मैंने भेज दी उनको सीधा डबल. So 1.2 lakhs words लिख के भेज दिए. So for you, but you know, I mean, I don't know if it was just to make me good, feel good. लेकिन editor said कि even though you wrote double, we like it, you know, and we don't want to cut it down. But since it has become so bulky, the price will go up, and since it's good, we would want it to be, you know, hardcover and all that. तो उसपे कुछ कुछ बातें चलती रही. And I told them कि भैया price ज़्यादा मत करो. I want it to be affordable. In fact, मैं तो एक set publisher के पास इसलिए गया भी क्योंकि एक book agent was there who had got in touch with me since faking news days. You know, 2010-11 की बात है. So he kept on since then he used to keep on pushing me कि you should. तो फाइनली जब मैंने लिख लिया तो मैंने उसको कहा कि यार तू बहुत बोलता था, मैंने बुक लिख लिया. एंड दैट्स हाउ आई एंडेड अप गोइंग थ्रू अ यू नो एन एस्टैब्लिश्ड पब्लिशर और अ मेनस्ट्रीम पब्लिशर, रूपा पब्लिकेशंस. तो अदरवाइज द वे आई वांटेड टू राइट इट नॉट टू सेल और नॉट टू बी पब्लिश्ड विथ यू नो एनी बिग पब्लिशर. नहीं तो मैं सेल्फ पब्लिश करके किंडल विंडल पे भी डाल देता. बट दैट वॉज द कॉन्टेक्स्ट और थोड़ा अच्छा भी लगता है. आई मीन यू नो लाइक अगर एक एस्टैब्लिश्ड पब्लिशर का है तो थोड़ी लेगेसी वाली भी फील आती है. तो मैंने कहा ठीक है. तो राइट, सो अभी इट शुड कम इन फेब्रुअरी वंस द एडिटिंग प्रोसेस स्टार्ट्स. एंड आई ट्राई कि थोड़ा जल्दी खत्म हो जाए. थोड़ा मक्खन लगाता हूँ कि और जल्दी कर दो और जल्दी कर दो. अभी तो फेब्रुअरी है.
चलो अच्छा, मतलब फिर बाद में बुक आ जाए तो तू भी एमिनेंट इंटेलेक्चुअल हो जाएगा, तेरी भी बुक आ गई.
नहीं भाई, मैं तो बिल्कुल आम शब्द में, आम भाषा में मैंने लिखा है. इनफैक्ट वी यूज्ड टू बी इन टच व्हाइल आई वाज राइटिंग द बुक. यू नो यू कैन डिस्क्लोज दिस टू द ऑडियंस कि मैंने तेरे को एक बार बोला भी था कि मैं तुझे मैन्युस्क्रिप्ट भेज देता हूँ, तू पता नहीं दिन रात कुछ ना कुछ पढ़ते रहता है, तू मुझे 50 कोट भेज दे कि मैं बुक में डाल दूंगा कि इंटेलेक्चुअल लगे, बट डिस्क्लोज इट टू पीपल दैट आई डिडंट डू इट, राइट? सो आई हैव केप्ट इट वेरी सिंपल. एक दो बार तो ऐसा हुआ ना कि मतलब वो चीज वो मेरी थॉट की थी, उसके बाद मैंने गूगल किया तो पता चला साला ये तो इसने कह रखा है, तो मुझे उसको कोट करना पड़ा. नहीं तो ऐसा होता है कि साला लोग कहेंगे कि भाई तूने उसका थॉट चुरा के डाल दिया. तो एक दो वैसी चीजें हुई, लाइक जॉर्डन पीटरसन का जो एक दो चीजें जो उसने बोली थी, विच आई हैडंट हर्ड, एंड देन आफ्टर राइटिंग एंड जस्ट आउट ऑफ क्यूरियोसिटी आई गूगल्ड एंड आई थॉट ओके इस बंदे ने भी वो कर बोल रखा है, तो मैंने वो फुटनोट में डाल दिया. अब इस तरह की एक दो चीजें और हो सकती हैं जो कि यू नो लाइक the publisher will add and stuff like that. So, ye sare hopefully by February it should end.
Yeah. Chalo, badhiya hai. Good. I'm looking forward to that. All right, guys, time to end the podcast. Once again, Rahul, thanks for coming on the podcast, and hopefully we'll have one more when the book is out. Guys, please go and support opindia.com, support the Op India Hindi channel, support the Op India English channel. Nupur has been doing some wonderful interviews over there. You can also go on the website and give them financial support. My association with Op India always remains. Rahul and I will always be frenemies, as they say.
Frenemies
होते हैं जिसको बोलते हैं राहुल, and he knows that he always has.
तू ये भी बता दे कि मैंने अभी तक तेरे को ट्विटर पे 2 बार ब्लॉक किया है.
दो बार किया मैंने, एक बार किया तो you have the upper hand.
तो pure frenemy. So on
that note, guys, once again, thanks for watching this live, and to the ones who are going to be watching it later, please leave your comments below, and all the abuses for Rahul and all the praises for me, and please subscribe to the podcast, like it. If you like what I'm doing over here, you can become a member on YouTube or join the subscription on Patreon. Today being a Saturday at 9 o'clock, I'm going to be resuming my discussion of the Valmiki Ramayana. Until then, I'll see you next time. Namaste. Take care. Goodbye.